from today is from 2 Samuel, and give a little bit of lead up. If you were here last week, you heard about some of the problems and consequences of David and Bathsheba. Well, now we're going to get into what happens with his children, and what is leading up to this story is, unfortunately, one of David's sons has decided to violate his sister, Tamar, and David does nothing about it, so that's where that story then picks up. And though Absalom never spoke to Amnon about this, he hated Amnon deeply because of what he had done to his sister. 2 years later, when Absalom's sheep were being sheared at Baal Hazor near Ephraim, Absalom invited all the king's sons to come to a feast. He went to the king and said, "My sheep shearers are now at work. Would the king and his servants please come to celebrate the occasion with me?" The king replied, "No, my son, if we all came, we would be too much of a burden on you." Absalom pressed him, but the king would not come. So he gave Absalom his blessing. "Well then," Absalom said, "if you can't come, how about sending my brother Amnon with us?" "I am one," the king asked, but Absalom kept on pressing the king until he finally agreed to let all his sons attend, including Amnon. So Absalom prepared a feast fit for a king. Absalom told his men, "Wait until Amnon gets drunk. Then at my signal, kill him. Don't be afraid. I am the one who has given the command. Take courage and do it." So at Absalom's signal, then the other sons of the king jumped on their mules and fled. Obviously, as we wrap this series up, these later years of David's life that are dealing with really close home life are some troubling stories, to say the least. I mean, we heard last week about how David basically broke every commandment in the book, and he had adultery, deceit, murder, assault. It all went down with David and Bathsheba, but this week we're now hearing about the repercussions of a lot of those actions, how they get played out in David's family life. And I'm not going to sugarcoat it. The issues that are involved in this week's story might make you feel a bit uncomfortable, because I know it makes me uncomfortable. But if we find ourselves feeling uncomfortable, then perhaps we're hearing things we need to hear. God declared that because of David's actions, the sword would never that he would constantly be caught up in turmoil and strife, and his sons would learn from their father how to handle situations in life. So the lasting repercussions of David's sin impacted not just him, but his entire family, in particular, his sons and children. The legacy that would follow would be that the throne of Israel would eventually be acquired through, because if you were here last week, that probably sounds familiar. David would promise the throne to his and Bathsheba's second child, Solomon. But David's son and Solomon's half-brother named Adonijah would make the mistake of asking if he could marry one of David's concubines, which would thus set him up to be the heir apparent. So Solomon kills him to get rid of him. This is the legacy he learned from his father. One of the instances between David's other children we are told of is so horrific. I don't know how any parent would react when it's one child doing this to another child, both of whom are yours. But David, after his tryst with Bathsheba, taught his sons that if you want something, you just take it. Even women. His son Amnon learned that just a little too well. And Amnon does the absolute unspeakable. We don't talk about that story much because it is a topic that is so disturbing. Even today, we don't mention it if we don't have to. We like to sweep it under the rug. We like to pretend it didn't happen. I mean, these are not the Sunday school versions of David's life we like to hear. The problem is, that's exactly what David did too. He decided to ignore it. Sometimes ignoring an incident like it never happened is the worst possible thing you can do, and it leads to things getting even more out of control. Because we never hear again from David's daughter, Tamar. She goes away, her voice is silenced, just swept up under the rug, never talked about. What happens when people who are in power and authority choose to do nothing in a case like this and just choose to pretend it never happened? Well, that doesn't mean it doesn't go away, or that it won't play itself out in some other way. He was furious, don't get me wrong, but he did nothing. And by doing nothing, he diminished not only the victim, his daughter, but by doing nothing, he fosters a hatred between his two sons. Because since Amnon never had to suffer the consequences of what he had done, his other son, Absalom, just fosters this hatred. It just keeps on building over the years until finally he sees to it that his sister is avenged and he murders his brother, Amnon. And truthfully, most of us can probably feel a bit of empathy towards Absalom and why he wanted to do that. Because if David, the one in power, had not ignored the problem and done something, then the situation would probably not have gotten out of control. But by doing nothing now, we have one son dead, we have another son on the run. Absalom ran away from what he knew would be his father's inevitable anger. And indeed, Absalom spent 3 years in a self-imposed exile until he was allowed to finally return to Jerusalem. And even then, it was another 2 years before David would speak to him. David was also understandably angry, but he eventually forgave. Sadly, this is not a story about a wonderful reunion of father and son. Once Absalom is allowed back into the king's good graces, that hate, that anger has set in so deeply that now he sets about undermining his father. Sets about winning over the hearts of the people and leading a rebellion against David. Most of us would think, well, okay, now he's killed his brother, he's overthrown David, and wants to kill David. So David probably is about at the point where he's ready to seek his own form of vengeance. And yet over and over again, we see one of David's biggest, what I would probably say is his redeeming quality, come through. The one thing his sons should have learned from him but did not. That no matter what his children have done, he still loves them. His own son wants him dead, and he still tells his generals to deal kindly with him when they find him. David finds himself in a very bad spot. I think maybe a lot of parents can identify with, not necessarily to this degree. I mean, this is family dysfunction at its most destructive. I think most parents have found themselves torn between loving a child, not wanting any harm to come to them when they get into trouble, trying to be protective of them, while also knowing there needs to be some sort of justice, which means at times allowing matters to take their course when their child has rebelled and gone down. So now David finds himself with the ultimate in rebellious children. Absalom doesn't just murder his brother, he openly rebels and supplants his father as the ruler of Israel. It doesn't get much worse than this. But if we step outside for a moment, step outside the story of David and Absalom, and try to see ourselves somewhere in this mess, who do we usually identify ourselves with? Are we David? Are we Absalom? Most parents probably see themselves much like David, torn between love and disapproval. Yet in many ways we are also a lot like Absalom. Because Absalom is representative of how humanity humanity behaves towards God, how we rebel and we try to supplant God in our lives, with ourselves, or other things in this world. How we allow things to consume us. The man after God's own heart, David, is any reflection at all of God. We begin to see maybe where the dilemma is for God with humanity. The problem God faces with each and every one of us. How we hurt one another. How we rebel against him and go our own way, do our own things. We read the Old Testament in particular, we tend to get a little judgy about God and what he does. He does some things that I think we all would call pretty horrific at times. Seems unusually cruel in some circumstances, something of a tyrant God who demands obedience, offers up stiff penalties for disobeying his commands. Yet the question I think we all have to ask is, would inaction have been a better course for God throughout the Old Testament? To take a hands-off approach, like how David took no action against Amnon, he violated his daughter. Is that the right and good thing to do? Or should Amnon have been punished for his crime? I mean, ultimately, he does get punished, probably much more severely by his brother than whatever punishment David would have doled out. This is the interesting and bizarre thing that we wrestle with, especially as Christians. One of my Old Testament professors in seminary used to say this, you probably heard me parrot it a few times in a sermon or two, but Ralph Jacobson was his name. He referred to God's wrath as the puzzling to human beings concept, that God loves our neighbors so much that God gets angry at us when we do or don't do things and cause them to suffer. It's a dilemma. God loves us. He loves our neighbor too, because they're his children as well. And when we set out to hurt each other, what is a father to do? We make him angry because we, as his children, hurt his other children. How do we act justly, but also with mercy and forgiveness, and how can those two ever coexist? Because unfortunately, the angry God is sometimes the only picture of God many people have, just like most teenagers think the only mood their parents are ever in is a bad one. They miss the anguished love that is many times behind it. And if we see David as that man after God's own heart, then God's heart is the love of his children, so much that he doesn't punish when he should, and he continues to allow us to hurt each other. And they take his course. He allows our decisions in life to have lasting effects, not just on our lives, but on our children's lives as well. Because the examples we set, they follow. So when we look at Amnon and Absalom as examples of humanity, we see what God has to deal with. We see the dilemma, we see the hurt and the love that goes along with all of this. We see the need for justice. We see the need for punishment when people do terrible things, but we also see the need for grace and for mercy. In David, the father of the king, we see grace, an extreme and almost offensive grace. A man who experienced forgiveness from God for his sin with Bathsheba, and a man who now extends that forgiveness to his children when they sin. After all, David was the author of Psalm 103. The Lord is merciful and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always accuse, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. We don't get what we deserve. As David knew the depths of God's love, having experienced the depths of God's love. tells us a story that is very similar to the story of David, in a sense. He tells the story of the prodigal son. I'm sure you're familiar with the story. The son who rebels and takes his inheritance, squanders it, and then is forced to return home. While the father had every right to tell the son, too bad, so sad, he throws a feast and he welcomes him back home. David could ask his generals to deal gently with his erring son, Absalom. How much more does the love of the Heavenly Father know no bounds? If it seems undignified to see Christ associating with prostitutes, racketeers, that's how God's undignified love always looks. It looks as undignified as a king like David, who had to flee as a fugitive, but was forgiving as a father. It looks as undignified as a father running wildly down the road to welcome his returning son. And that divine love comes running down among us into the most undignified places. That love came running down to a shepherd boy named David and made him the shepherd of Israel, forgiving him his many, 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 many failures and using him for divine purposes. It's 1,000 years later, in the fullness of time, and at the crossroads of the world, God's love comes running down into a foul stable at Bethlehem and ended up riding on a cross at Calvary to show us the heart of the Father. In this episode of David's life and in the cross of David's greater son, Jesus Christ, we see the awful mysteries of human sinfulness. The depth of love of God as a father. How God suffers because of what we do. How we suffer because of what we do. And yet God forgives us that which we do. Let us pray. Gracious and heavenly Lord, you are a God of mercy and forgiveness. Also a God of justice who seeks us to right wrongs. It's to you whom our hearts and souls are adoring. We ask you to open our ears and eyes to see you in this world that you have made. Despite the fact that sin permeates our world, it is still a beautiful world, filled with your overwhelming and all-encompassing presence. Let our hearts be filled with gladness, knowing that each day is a beautiful day simply because you are with us. Thank you for giving your selfless life so we can have eternal life with you. Teach us to live as you live, not as slaves to the law, but as sisters and brothers, free to love, free to share not only the blessings you have given us, but also the good news of the Spirit, stir up our hearts to reach out to the hurting and the sorrowful, the poor, the abused, the victimized. Let us not walk away from injustice, but advocate that which is right. Give us tasks equal to our strength. Give us strength equal to the tasks you have laid before us. Almighty God, you are always working to make things new. You renew our hearts, you renew our minds. You create new opportunities for love, mercy, and grace to be shared. And we wait with eager expectation to see your rejuvenating plans. Send your presence of healing and direction to those within our gathered body, to Darlene, Louise, Helen, Jim, Nick, Jeff, Sandy, Sue, Sharon, Joan, Karen, Greg, Mike, Judy, Donna, Jeff, Judy, Billy, Steve, Kristen, Joanne, Annette, Carrie, Kenneth, Megan, Bill, Chuck, Linda, Karen, Nancy, Justin, Bart, Evelyn, Rhett, James, Donna, Danny, Joel, Blaze, James, Jim, Billy, and Joe. For the friends and family of Eric Gonzalez, who joined in Savior last week. We pray this in all the name of Jesus Christ, who reigns with you in the Holy Spirit now and forever.